Good morning, and welcome to Compass Christian Church on this wonderful Pentecost Sunday. It's so good to see people wearing red today, and welcome to those that are joining us online. We're so glad that you could be with us today. If you are having a hard time seeing the screen and need words, Dawn, we have printed words. If you need them, just raise your hand. Dawn will get them to you. Okay. All right, all good. Would you please rise and join me in the call to worship? Sometimes our hearts are shut up like the doors that imprison the disciples. Come, Holy Spirit, with your mighty wind of justice. Blow open these doors and release us. Darkness floods our souls, and we wonder if we will ever see the light again. Come, Holy Spirit, let the flames of fire touch our hearts and our spirits and burn away our fears and frustrations. We sit huddled in our own worlds of alienation. When will we ever feel the power of your love again, O God? Come, Holy Spirit, fill our lives with your love and free us to reach out to others with the good news of your eternal presence. Please join us as we sing The Church's One Foundation. Come to us this day. Before us, remind us that we are never far from your presence. Get us ready for the great adventure and opportunities that lie before us. Help us to be good and willing workers for you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
As the children come forward for children's time, let's sing Jesus Loves Me.
The Bible tells me so. Little ones do they are weak, but He is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so.
Good morning. It's good to see you guys here again. So this morning I have this flashlight. I bet you guys have flashlights at home too. They're kind of fun to play with. And usually there's a button or a slide to switch it on. So mine has a button at the end here. So if I push it, oh, nothing happened, huh? No light. Let's see what the problem is. Here's the problem. There are no batteries. There's no power for it to make the light go. It's missing its power. So today, you might have noticed we've got red back there, and a lot of people out there are wearing red, and it's a special Sunday called Pentecost. So on Pentecost, a long time ago, with the disciples, this was after Jesus was raised from the dead on Easter, after the ascension when he went up to heaven, and the disciples were all kind of sitting around waiting for this gift that was promised them, the gift of the Holy Spirit that would help them share Jesus's love and power with the world. So they were sitting around waiting for this, wondering what was going to happen. And all of a sudden, this great wind came into the room and went whoosh, really noisy. And then, this is really strange, there were little flames of fire that landed on all their heads. Can you imagine? That would look kind of strange, right? And it didn't burn them. It didn't catch them on fire. There was just little flames. Does that look kind of silly? Yeah. But that was the Holy Spirit that came, and it gave them the power to share all the great things that Jesus said and did with everyone else. And that's how the church started, with that Holy Spirit coming and giving them the power. So let's go back to my flashlight here that has no power, right? Let's see if we can give it some power so that it can share its light, just like the disciples were able to share their light. So I have, you guys know what these are? They're batteries. It's in kind of a funny little container, but there's three batteries in there. So let's see. Now that my batteries are in there, I've got a light. The power is in the flashlight so it can share its light. Just like the Holy Spirit gave the disciples the power to share Jesus' love and light with the world. Okay, so that's a little bit about Pentecost. All right, will you guys pray with me? Dear God, we thank you for your Son Jesus that taught us all how to love each other, and for the gift of the Holy Spirit. It gives us the power to share that love with the world. Amen.
Amen.
And there's no worship and wonder for this summer, but you guys can grab some materials back there if you need something for during church, okay? Thank you.
Good morning. Excuse me. Okay, we have our list of prayer concerns that we are praying for continually. And are there any additions or new concerns or updates that anyone would like to share? Any joys? Okay, and then we shall proceed to, in preparation for our prayer time, we'll sing On Holy Ground, I think.
We are standing on holy ground. Spread
We'll begin our prayer time with a period of silence for your own personal prayers and needs in your own personal life, and then I'll close with a prayer. Our gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we thank you for your many blessings, and we come to you today in the name of Jesus. It's good to be able to come into your house and have this time to put aside the cares of life and the busyness of living. We're hurrying about, planning, preparing, fixing, organizing, and worrying about how everything is going to turn out. Even while we're here in church, those thoughts tend to drown out your voice and what you want to say to us. We do want to hear from you because we need to know again today that you're here and that you know us and where we are and in our walk with you. We pray for our leaders of our nation today and the many important and critical decisions they face. Give wisdom to our president and the cabinet members and the men and women in Congress. We pray for our military personnel stationed around the world. Be with them and bring them safely home. We pray now for those on our prayer list and for their families. Give them your special touch and reassurance so that they can know that you'll be with them in their time of need. We also pray for those needs in our hearts that we do not list, but we know and feel, and we pray for your help and guidance in those needs as well. We pray all these things in the name of their Son, Jesus Christ, and the prayer that he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our scriptures this morning are from Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 21. Listen for God's word. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as a fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every people under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us, in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus in Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, in our own languages we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power. All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, What does this mean? But others sneered and said, They are filled with new wine. But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, Fellow Jews and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days, it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days, I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. May the reading of his word fill us with the Holy Spirit.
Today we have a special privilege. Becky Lynn is on vacation. I think most of you know that. We hope that she's enjoying her time away. She did come to Women's Fellowship lunch on Wednesday and join us because she said, a girl's got to eat. So she came and joined us. Today I'd like to introduce our guest speaker who will be talking to us through video. Her name is Reverend Teresa Terri Hord-Owens. She was elected as our general minister and president of the Christian Church Disciples of Christ in July 2017. I knew a lot of you hadn't had a chance to meet her, so I wanted to give you a little bit of information, background information about who she is, so that you can relax and enjoy the video and know why she's doing this. As general minister and president of our denomination, she provides leadership for the General Assembly of the Christian Church Disciples of Christ in the United States and Canada. Her focus is to serve as the pastor and chief executive officer of the church, with a capital C. She is the first person of color and second woman to lead the denomination. A descendant of one of the oldest African-American free settlements in Indiana and a disciple since a young adult. Reverend Hord-Owens was Dean of Students at the University of Chicago Divinity School and pastor of First Christian Church of Downers Grove, Illinois, prior to her election. Reverend Hord-Owens' resume includes more than 20 years in corporate America, leading diverse teams in data management, in healthcare, in other industries before she entered seminary. After ordination, she served 15 years at the University of Chicago Divinity School, shepherding a varied student body in both background and theology. She is definitely connected to the Ohio region and is here often, serving as a preacher, speaker, and workshop facilitator. Her ministry and intellectual interests include a theology of reconciliation, cultural intelligence, developing inclusive and multicultural congregations, and the mentoring of young adults. She received her bachelor's degree in government Afro-American studies from Harvard University, Cambridge, Massachusetts, and her master of divinity from the University of Chicago Divinity School in Chicago, Illinois. In this video, she will be sharing the State of the Church address to the General Assembly of the Christian Church, Disciples of Christ, Reverend Teresa Terri Hord-Owens.
Thank you all. It is good to be in your presence, to see you physically. There have been limited opportunities for some of us to continue to gather, but there's an old spiritual that says, tell me, how did you feel when you come out the wilderness? Leaning on the Lord. And we have certainly been doing that over these past several years. I want to thank you for your patience, for your prayers, for your faithfulness, for your forbearance as we have pivoted as a church to do our business and do our work and make difficult decisions like canceling a general assembly, conducting general board online for the first time. We need to celebrate God's resilience in us, that we are still here. Amen. Tonight I want to begin, as I like to begin always when I preach. Whatever we do, we must first begin with what it is that we believe about God. What we believe about God drives what we understand about Jesus, and then it drives who we understand ourselves to be as church and the body of Christ. I have a scripture here on this slide. Too bad Tom Murray's not in the room. I was at Anointed Temple of Praise in Memphis, Tennessee in January, where I met Representative Justin Pearson, by the way, who's one of our own. And he had just been elected in the special election there. So we hold him close and we're glad to see that he's been restored to his rightful place. But the title of my sermon was, I Want God's Foolishness. You may have guessed over the past few years, I kind of like Walter Brueggemann. I like James Cone. I like a lot of people like Walter Brueggemann. When I was on sabbatical, I reread probably 3 or 4 times Prophetic Imagination and the Practice of Imagination. And I read a lot of things. And you know how sometimes when you read and reread and something hits you that you didn't see that was there before. In the introduction that he wrote to the 40th anniversary edition of that book, he talks about getting inside God's imagination. And this is the text, 1 Corinthians 1:25 through 27. For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. We've been talking about imagining God's limitless love. I believe all those omni words that I learned in Sunday school. That God is all present, that he is all knowing, that he is all loving, that he is never failing, that God is limitless. I use he, she. You may hear me go back and forward when I refer to God, so don't be upset about that. I believe that God can do anything. I believe that with God, nothing shall be impossible, and that there is nothing that we can imagine for our future as a church that God cannot accomplish. And if you don't believe that, we probably should just adjourn and go home. Let's go to the next slide. In February of 2020, I had been in retreat with a few folks who I wanted to help me think and vision after being elected and after our first General Assembly with me as GMP in Des Moines. And somebody asked me, we were in a safe space with folks who, none of whom were on the general board, people that were all disciples, nobody who worked for the church, just people that I like to think with and talk to. And somebody said to me, Terri, what excites you about what you've seen so far after 2 years of travel around the church? And said, what is giving me excitement and joy is when I see our church daring to imagine that things could be different. Daring to imagine that things can change. And so I came to you as a general board in February of 2020, and I said, we must imagine a new church for a new world. And I talked about having the courage to try new things, the courage to imagine that what currently exists might be different, that it might be possible, that something different could actually work. I talked about giving ourselves permission to change, giving ourselves permission to do something different. If you can back up to the point. Giving ourselves permission to change. And I also talked about walking in freedom. Freedom from fear of what happens when we change. Fear of what happens when we let go. Fear of what happens when the shifting sands beneath our feet throw us off balance. When we're called to live and lead in situations that we've never seen before. That was the middle of February of 2020. A group of us in Global Ministries had just spent 2 weeks in Southern Asia. Rick Spleth and Crystal Williams and I rejoiced that we got home safely from that trip. 3 weeks after that general board, we were in lockdown, and I was recording a video saying, my travel is suspended. You all follow the CDC guidelines and stay safe. 3 weeks later, the new world landed in our laps, and we were afraid, and we weren't sure what was going on. We didn't need permission to change anymore. We had to. We had to respond. We had to pivot. We had to figure it out. And the courage and resilience and creativity of our pastors all across the church, our regional ministers, we are coming out of the wilderness and we're still tired. We're still carrying the scars and the trauma and the fatigue of that experience, but we emerge not afraid. Let us not confuse fatigue with fear. It's okay to be tired. It's okay to wonder what's next. It's okay to question how and why. But let us not be afraid. Next slide. My friend Brueggemann, the prophet engages in futuring fantasy. The prophet does not ask if the vision can be implemented. Questions of implementation are of no consequence until the vision can first be imagined. The imagination must come before the implementation. Our culture is competent to implement almost anything and to imagine almost nothing. The same royal consciousness that makes it impossible to implement anything and everything is the one that shrinks imagination because imagination is dangerous. Every totalitarian regime is frightened of the artist because it is the vocation of the prophet to keep alive the ministry of imagination. To keep on conjuring and proposing futures alternative to the single one that the king or the institution or the system wants to urge as the only thinkable option. Church, we must shift our understanding. Not only do we need to change, it should change and it can change. When I was elected in 2017, when I think about the job description that I was given, I tell people it would scare you. We want vision. We want strategy. We want change. Do you? Do you? We must change. If the pandemic taught us nothing, we can't go back. There's no back to go to. Time has shifted. You may have seen in some presentations, the Council of Theological Education, President Charisse Gillette, who chairs that body, had a person from the Association of Theological Schools speak to us. And they talked about the difference between some short-time temporal changes, right? It's a bad storm that's coming through. And then there's the plates are shifting beneath the earth. There's an ice age, the marker that something major has happened. That's what happened to the pandemic. All around us, people are choosing different choices for institutions. We're working differently. The general ministries of the Christian church are mostly working on a 2 to 3 a day week basis from space that's since empty, and we're trying to sublet as much as we can. We're working differently. We've learned what we can do because we didn't have a choice. Let's go to the next one. One of the major items that's on the agenda for this meeting is what we've been calling the Covenant Project, GA 2343. And part of your job in your small groups will be to review, suggest changes, and think about what that means for the life of the church before sending it on to the General Assembly with whatever recommendation you have. The Governance Committee began meeting in a retreat, September of 2019, and we studied and prayed over the preamble to the design. Would you read it with me together? As members of the Christian Church, We confess that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and proclaim him Lord and Savior of the world. In God's name and by his grace, we accept our mission of witness and service to all people. We rejoice in God, maker of heaven and earth, and in God's covenant of love, which binds us to God and to one another. Through baptism into Christ, we enter into newness of life, and we are made one with the whole people of God. In the communion of the Holy Spirit, we are joined together in discipleship and in obedience to Christ. At the table of the Lord, we celebrate with thanksgiving the saving acts and presence of Christ. Within the universal church, we receive the gift of ministry and the light of Scripture. In the bonds of Christian faith, we yield ourselves to God that we may serve the one whose kingdom has no end. Blessing, glory, and honor be to God forever. Amen. That line that we've highlighted is the line that resonated with our entire committee. God's covenant of love, which binds us to God and to one another. Apart from a theological understanding of covenant, there is actually nothing in our polity that makes us do anything. We're a little allergic to authority and, sadly, even accountability in places. But the why of this is, as the called people of Jesus Christ, the tradition that we have as the Christian church disciples of Christ, this covenantal relationship, it begins at the table. We just celebrated Resurrection Sunday. Jesus says, "This is a new covenant in my blood." I used to say at the table as a pastor, "This is a new covenant between God and God's creation." That's where it starts. God has already rewritten and changed, and the revolutionary Christ that we celebrate as the resurrected Lord has shown us the way to have fellowship and reconciliation with God. And so therefore we must live in covenant and be reconciled to one another. That's why we must live as a reconciled covenantal people, followers of Jesus Christ. I began by talking about what it is that we believe about God. And I reminded you that back in 2020, we talked about having to imagine a new church for a new world, and we're in that new world. We've got important work to do today. We have questions, yes. Things that are unknown. But have you ever been on a cruise? One of the most fun parts of the cruise is leaving port. Big celebration, right? Everybody gets out on the deck and we're all excited that we're headed on this new destination. We realize that we're not getting there tomorrow, right? We know that this journey, we're not going to get there next week or even next year. But we got this big battleship of a church that we got to shift and turn directions, and we simply must begin. We can't stay in port and keep saying, "Well, we want a leader who's going to change things." And then we don't want to change. Well, what did you do? I don't have the authority to say, "So let it be written, so let it be done." If that were the case, it would have been done, I assure you. But I'm a part of this church. And God has called us all just to continue to be faithful. I wear the address of this scripture around my neck. Many of you, if you see me, you'll see it. It says Philippians 1 and 6. Here's where my confidence lies. I am confident in this, Paul says, that the one who began the good work in you will continue to complete it by the day of Jesus Christ. God doesn't promise a day of completion. That's not the point. And so my confidence, quite honestly, is not in any individual one of you. It's in our collective faithfulness to the God who has begun the work in us. to the tradition that we carry, like the African Sankofa bird. We must have our feet looking forward, and it's okay to reach back from our heritage or things that have worked for us that we want to carry forward. That's okay. But like that cruise sheet, we're not going to get anywhere until we leave port. And I want a departure ceremony that celebrates the fact that we're ready to go, that we believe and trust God to say, God, lead me, guide me all along the way. For if you lead me, I will not stray. Lord, let me walk each day with you. Lead me, O Lord, lead me. Let's go, church.
Amen. New is hard. Things are hard sometimes. Our pastor search is hard. Coming out of COVID has been hard. We're still here. We need to celebrate that. We need to enjoy being together. We need to become a church family. We need to care and love each other. To do that today. As we sing the next hymn, I will meet you down front, or later reach out to those of you on Zoom and share with you words that come directly from Scripture. And then we will look forward to your baptism in the near future. Maybe you've made that decision or a decision similar in years past, but today you would like to reaffirm or rededicate your life to Christ. We do it in the very same way. Or maybe today is the day you would like to join Compass Christian Church as a member of this family of Christ. We would be thrilled to welcome you. As we prepare our hearts for communion, we will sing together, Come Share the Lord. Let us come together today at this table to join in Holy Communion. The Gospel of Mark says this, while they were eating, Jesus took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, Take, this is my body. Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them. And all of them drank from it. He said to them, This is the blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I tell you, I will never again drink of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God. The deacons will serve communion to you. You will see that there are two cups nestled together. The bottom one contains the bread. Eat that as you are served. Please hold the cup and we will drink that together. If you are in need of special prayer, elders will be stationed around the sanctuary and are available to pray with you during communion. Because everyone is welcome at this table, you do not have to be a member of this congregation or this denomination to partake. Also, all of our communion is gluten-free. Let us pray.
Almighty God, this is your table, and the invitation now makes it ours. We thank you for the invitation. We ask your blessings upon this meal as we share. For it's in your holy name I pray. Amen.
Partake of this element together.
This morning, in addition to our regular tithes and offerings that we bring, I'd like to call your attention to the 2023 Pentecost offering. We started last weekend. We are going to continue it today. This is to help ensure our movement continues to embody the disciples of Christ's vision, which is to be and to share the good news, witnessing, loving, and serving from our doorsteps to the end of the earth. Half of your gifts supports the local New Church movement through your region's ministry. The other half supports New Church ministry efforts across the United States and Canada to equip, train, and empower new leaders. If you need any more information, the flyers are in the back. We ask you to please be generous. Thank you. Continue. Amen. It's been great to be here. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I'm going to read. Oh, she's got stuff to do.
On. Oh, yay. Yay. I'm electric. Church life events. I have to come down here because I can't see anything up there. It's all a mystery how all this stuff works. Steve knows how to do it, but I have no clue. So, summer lunch outreach. We have been asked to by Faith Alliance to help with a summer lunch outreach program. The women's ministry is doing this. We need to have two people every Wednesday at one location, and basically all we do is sit with the kids and visit with them while they're having lunch. We are not preparing lunch or anything. Is that right, Nancy? Okay, so there is a Sign Up Genius website that you can go and sign up. And we would love to have any of you who are not currently involved with the women's ministry, guys, anybody who's available, guys, can come too. Every Wednesday through the summer, we are helping with that ministry. It's an important ministry, and they were thrilled to have us volunteer to help out with that. The church office is closed tomorrow. It's Memorial Day holiday. They will be back in the office on Tuesday. Becky Lynn will be back from vacation. Lauren will be in the office. Stepping forward, May 30th, Ed. We're good. He's giving me a thumbs up. He has no clipboard in his hand, so we must have enough volunteers. Yes? Awesome. That's a great ministry. If you have not done that, consider it. What else do we have? Dave, nothing. We're done? We're done with all that? I was going to just now. Susan is back. She's hiding behind the keyboard and the television, but we are thrilled to have you here in person, my dear. Come back anytime you can. We, our regular keyboardist and her husband are traveling to Florida. They are visiting friends and family, and she will be back in worship with us next year. And Spirit Song, everybody stand if you can.
Thank you.
offer a blessing that is very, very ancient. And I'm going to challenge you to think about the words that are being read and the various parts of our creation that are mentioned in it. It's a Celtic blessing. May the road rise to meet you. May the wind be always at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face, and the rain fall soft upon your fields. And until we meet again, may God hold you in the palm